This is Justice, History, and the Law. Lectures, discussions, and interviews from the Robert H. Jackson Center in Jamestown, New York.
And now, from the August 30th edition of the International Humanitarian Law Dialogues, we have Greg Peterson of the Jackson Center introducing the speakers.
Without any further ado, the next part of the program I'd love to have introduced by Leila Sadat. Leila, who has been a 1045 lecturer here at the Chautauqua Institution. She is from Washington University School of Law. She has, as your program will indicate, just about every honor humanly possible. But we're just thrilled she's here to introduce our very special guest, Leila Sadat.
Thank you, everybody, and good afternoon. And hopefully everybody's pretty much gotten through their lunch and are ready for a real treat, which we're about to hear. So as a co-sponsor of these dialogues, I would like to add my warm welcome to this morning's warm welcome from Greg Peterson. Washington University School of Law is proud to be a co-sponsor of these dialogues, and as director of the Whitney R. Harris World Law Institute in St. Louis, I am particularly honored to come before you today, directly, in a sense, representing Whitney Harris, former Nuremberg prosecutor and advocate for international criminal justice. You heard a lot this morning about Rome and about Kampala, the two major diplomatic conferences that shaped the International Criminal Court as it exists today. And you will hear more about that this afternoon and tomorrow. Ben Ferenz highlighted one of the great paradoxes of our time, that the United States of America, the moving force behind the Nuremberg trials, has maintained a careful distance from the International Criminal Court. The Bush administration's early policy was to have the court, quote, wither and die. The current policy, fortunately, has moved away from that, but is nonetheless a form of cautious engagement. But where are the ringing tones of support, like the words that flowed from the pen of Robert H. Jackson so many years ago? Well, the paradox, in a sense, is that they are now coming from private U.S. citizens like Ben Ferenz, like Whitney Harris, and others, and from countries like France, or especially like Germany, who internalized the lessons of Nuremberg, brought them home, and themselves became a fan, in a sense, of this notion of accountability as a remedy to impunity. The German delegation to the Rome Conference, led by our keynote speaker today, Judge Hans-Peter Kaul, was the moving force, as you heard this morning, behind the insertion of aggression into the statute in Article 5.2. And again, at Kampala, I saw the German delegation extraordinarily effective and firm in insisting upon the crime's inclusion in the statute and leading the way towards the compromise that ultimately took place. You will hear more about that later. Germany and the United States are now fast and firm friends and allies, and Hans-Peter Kaul is someone who is and has been a great friend to the United States and its citizens. Along with his wife, Elizabeth, who also joins us here today, I feel like they're both part of our extended family. And on a personal note, I think that Anna Harris and her family and myself were so honored when they made the long trip from The Hague to St. Louis in May to attend the memorial service for Whitney R. Harris. And we thank you very much for your efforts. Now, Judge Kaul was elected on March 11, 2003, as one of the first judges of the International Criminal Court. He was elected for a term of 3 years and then re-elected in 2006 for a further term of 9 years. Second vice president of the court, as of March 11th of 2009, he will serve that function for 3 years. He's assigned to the pretrial division, and recently wrote a very interesting dissent on crimes against humanity that you can read if you're interested on the web. Judge Cowell qualified for the German bar, and in 2002 he was appointed ambassador and commissioner of the Federal Foreign Office for the International Criminal Court. From 1996 to 2003, he participated as head of the German delegation in the discussions and negotiation processes of the Rome Statute. At the same time, in his capacity as head of the Public International Law Division of the Federal Foreign Office, he was responsible for many cases involving Germany that were being heard before the International Court of Justice in The Hague, in a sense the civil court, unlike the ICC, which is the criminal court, including the Legrand case, which is well known to U.S. lawyers and which Germany won. He has written extensively on the International Criminal Court and other fields of public international law and has literally traveled the world all over, in addition to his important work as a judge, giving speeches about the court, such as the talk he's going to give today. Hans-Peter, Elizabeth, we are so honored to have you here today. We're delighted that you made the long journey once again from The Hague to the United States. And I hope that as Thomas Becker evoked for us this morning, that you will return to Europe with your spirit renewed and the comfort that you and the International Criminal Court have many, many friends and supporters in the United States of America. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving a warm welcome to Judge Hans-Peter Cowell.
Thank you very much, Laila. Our gracious hosts of this wonderful meeting at Chautauqua were kind enough, and this is somewhat unusual, to leave it entirely to me on which subject I should speak today. I'm, however, aware that this meeting is, by tradition, primarily a gathering of renowned international prosecutors, from Nuremberg through the present day. I'm also aware that the main topic of this meeting is crimes against peace, aggression in the 21st century. Consequently, I have decided that I will essentially speak on the role and contribution, enormous contribution, of three American prosecutors, namely Robert Jackson, Whitney Harris, and Benjamin Ferens, to the recognition and outlawing of the crime of aggression as a crime under international law. I will do so from the perspective of a citizen of Germany who was born still during the Second World War, who is reasonably aware of the history, terrible history, of the 20th century, and who, by the unpredictable circumstances of life, became in the 90s of the last century the German chief negotiator for the future International Criminal Court, and in 2003, as Laila has said, one of the first judges of this court. But before I go medias in res, I would also like to mention the following. 2 days ago, on Saturday, Elizabeth and I had the honor to meet in New York at the airport for the first time Bill Cummings, another Nuremberg prosecutor. Actually, we came here in the same plane. And when I now speak about Nuremberg, I'm aware that so many other Americans, distinguished American lawyers, Telford Taylor, Bill Cummings, and so forth, had their role in establishing the legacy of Nuremberg. Mr. Cummings, where are you? It is wonderful that you are here. Well, we all are aware that on 11th June 2010, the ICC review conference, unfortunately, I could not be there in Kampala, adopted a package proposal on the crime of aggression, which will probably provide the ICC after 2017 to some extent only, with jurisdiction over future crimes of aggression. Before the review conference, pessimism prevailed internationally as to the likelihood that an agreement could be reached. And my point is, and I will try to explain why, the successful outcome of the ICC review conference on the crime of aggression would not have been possible without the vision, without the groundwork of Jackson and the lifelong commitment of Whitney and Ben to the cause of peace and justice. Needless to say, I never had the chance to meet Robert Jackson in person. On the other side, in the 90s, I had during the ICC negotiation process the chance to become acquainted and even modestly befriend outstanding American jurists and former Nuremberg prosecutors, in particular Whitney and Ben. It is on this basis and my memories from a number of personal encounters where we have been together that I will try to illustrate their exemplary work against aggressive war making, a work which has given hope to so many in our international community, in our global community. Berlin, 3 May 2010, 2 weeks after the passing away of Whitney. A conference is held on the crime of aggression in preparation of the ICC review conference in Kampala. The German government wants to prepare its position. Ambassador Werner Weser, the president of the ICC Assembly of State Parties, is present. A number of Bundestag members and government officials, a good audience, some journalists. The situation for me as ICC vice president is a bit delicate, is a bit difficult. Why? I myself took part in deciding the court's policy. ICC judges should not comment on the forthcoming negotiations in Kampala. The discussion of the crime of aggression is a matter for the state's parties alone. Eventually, I say, with some hesitation, and I recall this almost by heart, as an ICC judge, I cannot speak on the crime of aggression and the forthcoming negotiations. But as a German citizen who was born during the Second World War and who knows Article 26 of our Constitution, the basic law containing a prohibition of aggressive wars, I feel very close to two American pioneers for the proscription of the crime of aggression, both US prosecutors in Nuremberg, namely Whitney Harris and Benjamin Ferenc. And as you may know, Whitney Harris passed away recently in St. Louis on 21 April 2010. He was a prosecutor of the International Military Tribunal in the case against Kaltenbrunner, the head of the Nazi secret police, the Gestapo. And Whitney published a book in 2004 called The Tragedy of War. And I would like to cite only one phrase out of the epilogue of this book. The crime of aggressive war, said Whitney, must be recognized, defined, and punished when it occurs, for war is the greatest threat to the survival of civilization. Benjamin Ferenc, prosecutor in the so-called Einsatzgruppen case, was just awarded with the Erasmus Prize in The Hague Royal Palace for his lifelong work. The headline of his website reads Law, Not War. Ferenc will soon travel to Kampala to attend the discussions on the crime of aggression with tremendous energy and charisma despite his age. Both Harris and Ferenc basically agree on the following. The common task is about repressing, preventing, and banning the waging of aggressive war. And I concluded, it seems essential to me. It would indeed be wonderful if Kampala would bring about real progress and a breakthrough for the outlawing and penalization of the crime of aggression. Why do I report about this conference, about this episode, which may seem small to all of you? Well, to demonstrate to you, to an essentially American audience, that on this May, 3 May 2010 in Berlin, 6,000 kilometers from here, the principles, the ideals, and the lifelong commitment of Whitney and Ben, two former aides of Robert Jackson in Nuremberg, were present in the capital of Germany. They had an impact. And I'm not sure that many Americans really understand what the ideas, principles, and vision of Jackson, Whitney, and Ben have done internationally for this country, the United States of America. And it is wonderful that Anna Harris and Ben are today with us. Ben, you are indeed the first former Nuremberg prosecutor whom I met back in 1996 at the August PrepCon. It was obvious to all that Ben was already then the leading and eloquent, inspiring, mesmerizing advocate for the inclusion of the crime of aggression in the statute of the future international court. And when we, on the German side, prepared for the February 1997 PrepCon, I got the green light from the top level of the German Foreign Office that we would be authorized to table a new concrete text proposal on the crime of aggression. And before flying to New York, I sought the advice of leading international lawyers, leading authorities in Germany, for example, Professor Tomuschat, Professor Zimmer, now the current German ICJ judge, Professors Frohwein and others. Needless to say, they all were quite aware of the historic complexities of the issue of crimes against peace, aware of the painful and often frustrating efforts to achieve progress. And they hardly managed to hide their skepticism, even irony, when they said, "Good luck. Really good luck, Mr. Kaul." And when my delegation arrived in New York at the PrepCon, the discussion on the crime of aggression was low-key, if not dormant. But in May 1997, the International Criminal Court Monitor, a newsletter by the NGO coalition headed by Bill Pace, whom we will hear this afternoon, commented, and I have this piece from 1997 here. During the February PrepCon, many of the states spoke in favor of the inclusion of the crime of aggression, and Germany's proposal on aggression was particularly helpful in lending focus to this debate. 2 months later, Lionel Yee, the respected head of the Singapore delegation, added, quote, "A draft consolidated text defining aggression is before the committee now, and much credit for this should go to the German delegation's efforts." It was during the Rome conference that I became eventually quite close in a relationship of trust and confidence with Whitney and Ben. Those who know the story of the Rome conference will also know that both of them were, time and again, a source of encouragement and inspiration for many delegations, but in particular for the German delegation. You might even say that sometimes they acted behind the scenes as informal advisors to my delegation. And Whitney and Ben were unanimous in their view that the crime of aggression should be within the jurisdiction of the ICC. Having them on our side was an invaluable source of encouragement to my delegation not to resign, not to give up in our quest for a credible international criminal court. The ICC is the direct heir of Nuremberg, of the downfall of Germany to barbarism under the Nazis. First, the persecution of Jews, then the invasion of Poland on 1 September 1939, a textbook example of a war of aggression, of a crime of aggression that led directly to the Second World War, with all the ensuing crimes against peace, crimes against humanity, and war crimes. And given our own experiences, our own past, I believe it is only right that Germany did its best for the establishment of an effective, functioning, independent, and thus credible international criminal court. It is also widely accepted, if not common knowledge, that without Germany, the crime of aggression would not have been incorporated in Article 5 of the Statute, our founding treaty. And the German proposal, which was the last on the table, at least made sure that the crime of aggression was reaffirmed as an international crime. It is here once and for all in Article 5 of the Statute. Now, from today's perspective, it seems obvious that this was, and many were then frustrated and did not understand it properly, of fundamental importance. Because if the crime of aggression had not been recognized as such, at least with this placeholder, a provision of Article 5 of the Statute, we probably all, the international community, would have been faced with the following consequences. One, this would have meant a setback, if not a dramatic regression in international law. It would probably have been interpreted or misinterpreted as a rejection of the lawfulness of the concept of crimes against peace as enshrined in the Charter of the International Military Tribunal of Nuremberg. It would even have meant an implicit rejection of the vision and crucial role of Jackson. And two, this would have been a triumph for all those who continue to argue and say exist even today, that it is simply impossible to regulate power politics and the use of military force through our norms of law. Three, there would have been no mandate and no basis for further work on the codification of the crime of aggression. Four, there would also have been no mandate and no basis for the Special Assembly of States Parties Working Group on the Crime of Aggression, which over 7 years here in the United States of America, in Princeton and in New York, prepared the ground for the breakthrough in Kampala, with Ben and Whitney acting time and again as inspiring advisors. And with the permission of Anna, I would like to recall once more before this audience the memorable visit of Whitney and Anna in Berlin in October 2000, when Whitney was a guest of honor in the German parliament. Why this? Because one can see, you can see in a nutshell, what the work of Jackson, Telford, Taylor, Whitney, Ben and others means for many in Germany. You will now see five pictures covering 55 years from 1945 to 2000, which Whitney and Ben have also seen as witnesses of history. This picture is known even nowadays to most people in Russia, from old veterans to young school kids. Why? Because it shows the victory of the Red Army in 1945, the conquest of Berlin, and the conquest of the center and of the Reichstag. And by the way, one should not forget, and I take the liberty of recalling this, that Russia was the victim of a crime of aggression committed on 21 June 1941. And one should not forget that the war has cost the lives of more than 20 million people of the proud Russian nation. This is the Reichstag, and I think that the picture speaks for itself. This is the man who in 2000 visited Berlin together with Anna. But here we have him in Nuremberg, well, a colonel, a lieutenant at Nuremberg. And this is the Reichstag at the time of the visit of Whitney Harris. This was, one should know that it has lasted 50 years to rebuild this building, and only in 1999 did the German government move from Bonn to Berlin. And when Whitney and Anna arrived, we were just 1 year again in our capital. And it was the special wish of Whitney to be present when the German parliament would adopt the ratification law for the future International Criminal Court. On 27 October, Whitney sat on the gallery of the Reichstag reserved for the guests of honor, the only one on this gallery above us. The gallery is here on the left side, and down in the center you have the speaker's podium, and to the left from the speaker's podium you have the government bench, and I myself was sitting behind Chancellor Schröder and Foreign Minister Fischer on the bench reserved for the senior civil servants. And when the ICC law was adopted, Deputy Foreign Minister Vollmer took the floor and said, "Dear colleagues, as many of you are already aware, we have as guest of honor Whitney R. Harris, a former Nuremberg prosecutor and aide of Robert Jackson. May I propose that we rise from our seats in honor of his work and all what Nuremberg has done for the German people." And all parliamentarians from all parties, from the left to the right, rose, and the records of the German Bundestag note a standing ovation and long applause. Another event which has left a deep mark in my memory is the symposium Judgment at Nuremberg held in Washington University in St. Louis from 29 September to 1 October 2006, on the 60th anniversary of the judgment of the International Military Tribunal at Nuremberg. As many who were present during this extraordinary conference are also among us today, including Ben and Anna, I can be brief. There were several aspects of this outstanding conference whose proceedings are published in this edition of the Washington University Global Studies Law Review, which I found particularly impressive. In hindsight, it seems clear that in particular Whitney and Lila were the driving force for this excellent conference. And firstly, there was the quality, the profoundness, and the impartial fairness of the speeches and contributions made, and this includes in particular those of Whitney, Ben, and Henry T. King Jr., the three Nuremberg prosecutors. Secondly, and this is a very important point, the conference was on an event 60 years back, but it was entirely future-oriented. If I remember well, I have hardly ever participated in a conference attempting so seriously to identify the lessons for the present and the future to be drawn from the terrible crimes and human catastrophes which had to be dealt with at Nuremberg. We were all reminded in a powerful way by many what Jackson thought about the crime of aggressive war. Today, I belong myself to the many Germans who believe the most important point of Nuremberg was the conclusion that aggressive war, which had been a national right and which some today still consider a national right, should henceforth be punished as an international crime. As Ben has said, this was a revolution. It was a revolution in thinking. As we are talking about the lessons from the last century, please permit me to mention a brief correspondence that I had in early 2008 with Ben. I will again use three pictures to introduce this episode. Well, on the first picture, you see the ruins of the Brandenburg Gate and the Reichstag in Berlin in 1945. I'm myself quite familiar with pictures of such destruction. They were, needless to say, the almost daily reality of my childhood and youth. I was born nearby Dresden, the capital of Saxony, one of the most beautiful cities of Europe, totally destroyed by the devastating air raids from 13 to 15 February 1945, looking then like Sodom and Gomorrah. It is the first city I have vivid memories of as a child in 1946-1947. This was the totally ravaged Dresden, a city littered with ruins where beaten tracks through the rubble served as streets. Also at the time, as a small boy holding his mother's hand, I found this quite normal. But when I became an adult, it did not take long to make me understand that the wiping out of Dresden in those murderous air raids, by current standards of international humanitarian law, certainly a particularly serious war crime pursuant to Article 8 of the statute, was nothing else than another terrible consequence of the aggressive war started by Adolf Hitler and his followers. The next picture has also to do with the catastrophic situation in which Germany was plunged after its aggressive wars. It also has to do with Ben. I found this picture around Christmas in 2007 in the Academy of Arts nearby the Brandenburg Gate. It caught my interest. The picture is of Berlin in 1945, and it shows ruined buildings and piles of rubble. And on a wall, which somehow had remained standing, someone had written three words, only three words, in large white letters, "Nie wieder Krieg," never again war. And we know how hungry the people were in Berlin in 1945, what deprivations they suffered, how they fought to survive each day. And nevertheless, and this is what moved me, there were individuals or small groups who crisscrossed the entire city with a bucket of paint and a brush to spread the message as wide as they could, "Nie wieder Krieg." I was moved by this idea. Since I know that Ben Ferenc, and you see him here as a handsome young Harvard lawyer, and he hasn't changed. I know that he had been in Berlin after the war. We sent this card in America to him with our greetings. And we soon heard back from him on 6 January 2008. And with his permission, I would like to read his email, which I have printed out once again before coming here, and he writes back, "I vividly recall the scene depicted in your photo of Berlin, Nie wieder Krieg. I hope one day, with your help, we can add a postscriptum, Krieg ist strafbar, war is a criminal offense. I'm still working on it." Yes, indeed, Ben, you and Whitney and so many good people kept working on it with steadfastness and determination. And now, against all odds, against most expectations, we have since 11 June 2010 a full and agreed package proposal on the crime of aggression. It closes, in all likelihood, the last important remaining lacuna in the substantive law of the Rome Statute. And we now have, and that is the importance of it, a yardstick, a measurement. We have an agreed standard to determine whether a crime of aggression was committed or not. And it is not my role as a judge of the ICC, nor my intention to delve into the intricacies and maybe even weaknesses of the complex proposal which was adopted. And in this regard, I look already forward to the dialogue on the crime of aggression, which immediately will take place after my remarks at Fletcher Hall. Instead, let me share with you, to conclude, three or four considerations of a more general nature. First, it was, in my view, absolutely right and timely that the organizers of this important symposium devoted it to a dialogue on crimes against peace, aggression in the 21st century. The outcome of the ICC review conference is, in my view, also part of the legacy of Nuremberg and of the pioneer role of Jackson, Whitney, Benn, and others. And what is needed now, and we are engaged in it, is a meaningful dialogue on the implications and consequences of this major step in the development of international criminal law. Not only the distinguished participants of this conference, but leaders all over the world, including those in Washington, are called upon to reflect which conclusions they may draw from the adoption of the amendment to the Rome Statute on the crime of aggression by consensus. They may reflect, I think they should reflect, on which policy they may henceforth follow in this field. Second, please permit me to share with you some personal thoughts on the use of military force for political purposes and on the phenomenon of war in general. I note that my own thinking with regard to these issues has changed and evolved considerably in the past decades. Like Whitney and Ben, I also served in the military as a captain and paratrooper in the German army, and then after the Cuban Missile Crisis, at the peak of the Cold War, I wanted, and this was genuine, like others, to defend the West against the communist threat. Therefore, I believe that I'm not in danger of falling for naive pacifism. But when we reassess today, crimes against peace, and this is the subject of this symposium, let me reaffirm what I said 2 years ago in Cologne, another 2,000-year-old treasure founded by the Romans and totally destroyed as a consequence of Hitler's aggressive gamble. War, and I think that you will find my findings close to the one of Ben. This is the ultimate threat to all human values. War is sheer nihilism. War is the total negation of hope and justice. And experience shows that war, the injustice of itself, begets massive war crimes and crimes against humanity. And once again, in my own words, this time as blunt and unpleasant as a reality itself, war crimes, they are the excrement of war. They are an odious and inevitable, inescapable consequence of war. And we have seen this time and again in the Second World War, in Vietnam, in the former Yugoslavia, in Iraq, also in practically all African situation states with which the ICC is currently seized. As in the past century, a terrible law, it is no law, but a terrible mechanism seems to hold true. War, the ruthless readiness to use military force, to use military power for political interests, regularly begets massive and grievous crimes of all kinds. Recently, Professor Michael Bolander, a German professor now teaching in South Africa, has reminded me about a further appalling aspect of this evil. Even nowadays, in modern warfare, in the time of so-called surgical strikes, you have heard this notion, 80 to 90% of war casualties are regularly civilians, mostly children and women, and I need not comment on this. Third, given this situation, it will not surprise anybody that when learning about the outcome of Kampala, and I would like have to be there, with regard to the crime of aggression, I felt not only relief but satisfaction. And I have heard from various sources, and Leila has confirmed it, that the German delegation in Kampala, most of them my former collaborators in Berlin and even members of my delegation during the Rome conference, Professor Klaus Kress and others, had again an important and constructive role in the negotiations. And 10 days ago, Dr. Wasim Rainer, the current legal advisor of the German Foreign Office, the counterpart of Harold Koh, told me in an informal meeting at the ICC that Germany will endeavor to ratify quite soon the amendment on the crime of aggression to the Rome Statute adopted in Kampala. There is little doubt that this treaty will soon have an Article 8 bis and Article 15 bis and Article 15 ter incorporating the crime of aggression. And my last remark concerns a programmatic announcement which Jackson made in his opening statement before the International Criminal Military Tribunal on 21 November 1945 in Nuremberg. In my view, this announcement, and he has said many important things in this day-long speech, this announcement continues to be of fundamental importance for the crime of aggression even nowadays. You will probably recognize again these well-known sentences when I quote the following words of Jackson. But the ultimate step, he said, in avoiding periodic wars, which are inevitable in a system of international lawlessness, is to make statesmen responsible to law. And let me make clear, he said in Nuremberg, that while this law is first applied against German aggressors, the law includes, and if it is to serve a useful purpose, it must condemn aggression by any other nations, including those which sit here now in judgment. Now, why are these programmatic, these far-sighted sentences, even nowadays, of such a tremendous importance? Well, because they set out the vision, they set out the promise that international law relating to crimes against peace will be applied in the future in an equal manner vis-à-vis all possible aggressors. Because they set out the vision and the principle of equal law for all, equality before the law with regard to crimes against peace. The principle of equal law for all, equality before the law, is a general principle of law recognized by civilized nations within the meaning of Article 38(1)(c) of the Statute of the International Court of Justice. Yes, law must apply to everyone equally. While there are some in this world, and maybe also in this country, and you will know better, who want to ignore this principle, who maybe want to push back, who want to push it back. There are, however, also many in this great country who actively support and work for full respect of the principle of equal law for all, equality before the law. And this gives hope, much hope, and encouragement. Thank you very much.
The Jackson Center is a historical and educational facility dedicated to preserving the legacy of this country lawyer who became Solicitor General, Attorney General, a Justice of the Supreme Court, and served as chief prosecutor at the Nuremberg trials of Nazi war criminals following World War II. To learn more about this program, Robert Jackson, the Jackson Center, and upcoming events, the Jackson Center is located at 305 East 4th Street, Jamestown, New York, and found on the web at www.roberthjackson.org or contacted by telephoning 716-483-6646.